Everyone, and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Justice Subcommittee on Policing in 2017. No apologies have been received. Can I at the start invite John Finney to make a short declaration?
Yeah, thank you. Given the nature of our discussions today, Karina, I should indicate that I'm in receipt of a police pension.
Thank you for that, John. Our first agenda item today is a decision on whether to take item three in private, which is consideration of our future work programme. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business is an evidence session on Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority's short-term financial planning. And can I welcome our witnesses today, Craig Suttie, the General Secretary of the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, Calum Steele, General Secretary of the Scottish Police Federation, and George McIrvine is not...
Sorry.
Can I welcome Drew Livingston, last-minute replacement for George McIrvine, Branch Secretary of Unison Scotland and Police Scotland. You are very welcome, and can I thank the thank you for providing written evidence. We will move straight into questions, and can I refer members to paper one, which is written by the clerk, and paper two, which is a private paper. Can I perhaps start by asking our witnesses what their thoughts and views are, and if there have been any changes, in including you in discussions about financial planning and priorities, because we have been quite concerned in the previous evidence sessions that we have that there seems to have been almost an exclusion of staff associations and unions from any discussion around those matters. And it's quite concerning given that the police force relies heavily on its staff, and to completely exclude them from all those discussions would seem to me to be quite unsatisfactory. And I just wonder perhaps if you'd like to give us an update on whether there has been any change to that, because we have received a commitment that that would change, and I just wonder if there has been any change.
If I can start, yes. Certainly, we haven't seen any longer-term financial planning for the next 3 years. I believe that is going to be influenced by the Policing 2026 strategy. In terms of how we actually see it, we find it reassuring that there's certain commitments to engage us in further talks as to what sort of financial planning will take place. There are some concerns regarding, for instance, in this year's budget, we're actually aware that there's a kind of £4 million non-recurring vacancy factor saving, which is listed on the police staff budget. We're not entirely cited as to what that's broken down into and what areas of the business are affected by that. So, it isn't great at this moment in time, but certainly there is a commitment that it will improve.
Just before I bring in Callum and Craig, who I'm sure will want to add something, when you say there's a commitment, has there been a commitment as in we will include you, or we will include you and this is how we will include you?
Certainly, Unison did raise some concerns regarding the governance structure that was actually going to form part of the renewed approach to the SPA's governance. We have had a commitment that will be looked at over a six-month period. As far as we're concerned, it should probably take place sooner. And so we just kind of need to see. David Page has given commitments that we will be included, and he does look to include us and take us with us on that journey. But obviously, we need to actually see how that's going to take shape.
Okay, thank you. Callum, do you want to come in next?
I think probably not too dissimilar from the position that Drew has articulated would probably be a close description of where we are. I mean, the SPF is aware of the generalities and the wide issues that are facing the service. And we have had more engagement with the Scottish Police Authority in particular, and also with the Chief Financial Officer fairly recently, just around about those generalities. So we're aware of what was in the budget that was going to be presented to the SPA. But in terms of dealing with the challenge that is there in black and white for everyone to see, there has been no detail shared. More importantly, I don't think there's been, in fact, I can say that there hasn't been, never mind a question of I don't think, there has been no specific effort to seek from us suggestions as to what could be done to mitigate or ameliorate some of the challenges that are coming. Now, I personally find that frustrating. You know, we are not, you know, we are not an organisation to be patted on the head and stuck in the corner. Our members, and in fact all of our members, both Drews and Craig sitting to my right and left, they see the realities of what takes place on the ground on a day-to-day basis, and they also have more than an appreciation of what some of the language round about sustainability and so on means. It means cuts, but there's an unwillingness, it would appear, to exactly say what those cuts are going to amount to, other than very broad aspirational statements about taking X from here and putting them there.
Okay, Craig.
Again, just reiterate what's been said. I mean, just to add, we've had significant consultation about 2026, and we found that to be very positive, but that's very much at strategic level, and what we really want to get into is the detail of the delivery plans and implementation plans, and we've had no detailed discussion over that, although the executive and the SPA have been quite open to us to discuss in general terms where things are going, but until we get into that detail, and in particular what the operating model is going to be in future and how we're going to change the organisational culture, that we'd like to get involved in, and like Calum, and I'm sure Drew, we'd like to assist with that as well.
Just before I bring in Margaret, who wants to continue this line of questioning, can I ask you then what impact, if any, this has had on the morale of the force?
If I may, convener, I mean, I actually don't think it's done much to improve it, but given that we're at a starting point that was re-established again in December 2016, that only 8% of police officers, I've distilled the figures down for police officers, believe that the organisation is genuinely interested in its people. You know, things can really only go up, although I thought that in 2015 when we had the original survey, but it turns out they went down. Police officers, by and large, tend not to really care about the money. They just want to make sure that they're capable of doing the job. The reality, of course, is that when there's a lack of money, that impacts on their ability to do their job. The things that have the biggest impact, and certainly that create the biggest source of anxiety for our members, comes from resources. We have, and I regularly hear from members who express the greatest of frustrations at working in shifts that have been, if not quite decimated, certainly very close to it. They are constantly chasing their tails, and whenever they hear the management language of sustainability and efficiencies, they know, because of the many years the service has taken in trying to invest in their skills, that they know that that's going to be harder for them, because they have no experience of it being any better when this kind of language is used.
Yeah, because I mean, you recently said, Calum, that policing was really under the cosh, and you mentioned the ludicrous working hours and demand and officers starting shifts with dozens of jobs outstanding. I take it there is no change to that position.
Well, I would like to think that the dozens that were outstanding when I wrote that submission have at least been dealt with. But the general trend and pattern of picking up many, many jobs from the previous shift continues. To some extent, it was ever thus. You know, there were always jobs. You know, if a call came in half an hour before the changeover of shift, the reality was that unless it was an absolute pressing emergency, that would be bound over to someone else. But it's developed to a large extent from them. From then, in that many calls are just simply unable to be got to, rather than just being a coincidence of timing.
Drew or Craig, do you want to comment additionally?
Certainly, I mean, our experiences are very similar. The Pulse survey offered a bit of insight into how staff and how morale is within the organisation. From a police staff perspective, there's been significant delays to the harmonisation programme of work, which sees huge differences in the rates of remuneration for police staff across the board. That was picked up on by HMICS in the review of call handling, where you have police staff working alongside other police staff and they're receiving different rates of pay. That was initially meant to be addressed in October 2016 and it has had to be put back. We have hundreds of police staff vacancies across the organisation which aren't being filled. A lot of the cost-cutting measures have been to reduce police staff numbers so that we could experience recurring cost savings as a result of cuts to police staff. Police staff are increasingly being asked to deliver a lot more with less, and that's having a huge impact on morale. But due to their ongoing professionalism, they will continue to deliver a service. You only have to look at the example with Aberdeen staff who carried on delivering a service for C3, even though there were imminent closures. So, you know, above and beyond is how police staff go about the business.
To say, Calum and Drew both said it, that Federation members, police staff members, and indeed members of ASPS are overstretched just now. They're working beyond what I think can be reasonably expected of them in many cases. I think the organisation, the service, is trying to address some of these issues. I think 2026 is a good example where there have been some real attempts to go out and speak at frontline levels. However, until we see some demonstrable change or change to the organisational culture and an indication what the operating model is going to be, it's very difficult for staff to actually accept that and see what difference are being made. And it's going to be a critical time. I mean, the budget's quite clear that it's challenging just now. It's going to become even more challenging over the years ahead. And if we don't engage with staff, we're going to have real issues.
Okay, thank you. Margaret.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Just following up on the engagement issue, you will be aware the committee has been sent today a letter from Derek Penman, HMI Inspector of Police, and it is very critical, it's fair to say, of the decision of the SPA to hold meeting, committee meetings in private. In particular, I wanted your view on what Mr. Penman had raised in terms of oversight and scrutiny. He refers to the Audit Committee, the Finance Committee and the Policing Committee of SPA, all these being in private, and he makes a particular point that the new Policing Committee in particular will deal with a range of business that would previously have been heard in public, and as such, of course, you would be party to everything that was discussed. Specifically, operational performance and complaints handling. So can I ask how early you were aware of this letter and these concerns and your comments specifically on operational performance previously being held in public and now being behind closed doors in the SPA committees?
Obviously, Unison are particularly concerned. We've been quite vocal in terms of how the SPA and Police Scotland go about their business. I think it's important when you're undergoing massive structural change within an organisation, it's important that you take your staff with you. Now, as we have been quite outspoken and quite critical, I think there's been a reluctance on the part of the organisation to actually listen to opinions which may come across as slightly dissenting.
When you were aware of this letter and these concerns that HMICS had brought up with Andrew Flanagan?
The first that we became aware of it, I believe, would be when the article actually appeared in the press in relation to the letter not actually being put forward at the board meeting.
Would that be roughly?
That would probably be 6 weeks ago, maybe.
6 weeks ago. Okay.
Around about the story with Moy Alley and these instances started coming to light.
Okay. Mr.
Yeah, Steele? Convener, likewise, I was aware of the existence of the letter at the time that I think it was Paul Hutchin ran the story in either the Herald or the Sunday Herald. And I think the timing, as Drew alluded to, was about 6 weeks ago. In addition to that, the matter was touched on at fair length by John Scott QC at the recent Scottish Police Federation conference. Mm-hmm. But on the specific issue of the manner in which the SPA is conducting its business, I fundamentally believe that it undermines its legitimacy. The views of the SPF on the approach to the SPA is that whilst what existed in the past with police boards and authorities may not necessarily have been overly effective, there could be no doubt that they had legitimacy because of the ability of the public to be involved in them, or certainly to see what was going on. Mm-hmm. And whilst I appreciate that the jury may be out on this, but it's certainly my view that to some extent what we currently have is more effective, but it is a lot less legitimate because of this closed-door approach.
I think my point specifically was that this was the 8th of December. This was raised as an issue, saying, you know, in public, this was held in public before. You would have had an opportunity to see some of the finance committee's deliberations. You would have had an opportunity to comment on the operational performance that had been held in public. So that's months being wasted of information that could have been provided if someone had looked at this. 8th of December, HMICS has brought this to our attention, is most unhappy with it. It isn't the best practice of effective scrutiny and transparency. I would have hoped somewhere along the line somebody would say, right, we must fix this right away, like January, February at the latest. Instead, we've had more months of the association representations, representatives and Unison being kept totally in the dark.
The thing is, convener, sorry, through yourself, convener, I don't disagree. The correspondence was from HMICS to the Scottish Police Authority. Mm-hmm. If the chair of the authority declined to share that content of the correspondence with members of the authority itself, it doesn't really come as a surprise that it wasn't shared much further.
I think the concerns actually came back much earlier than that. It was actually when the governance review came out, which was about the middle of last year, when that came out, we had some concerns at that time. I agree with what Calum said about the previous organisations with regard to the police boards, some very effective ones, but there were some shortcomings in that. Actually, with the openness of the board meetings in the early years of the SPA, I'm not sure we were always being listened to even then. We got the chance to sit, but we didn't actually get the chance to speak. And there's many issues. I heard the chair speaking about some of the things that he said Police Scotland got wrong, round about armed policing, round about stop and search, traffic wardens. He could have gone to talk about the performance model, the CCU. They are all things which the staff associations and the trade unions were bringing to attention, the force executive and the SPA before that time. It's a question of whether they were listening to us and whether anything was being done about it. I'm encouraged that the new arrangements that are put in place, we've now been invited along to the People Committee on the 27th of April, and I think colleagues have been invited along to that committee as well. It'll be interesting to see how we're listened to or how we engage with the SPA at that time.
I think it wasn't just a case of just having where you listened to even then. It was a case of you knew exactly what was being discussed. Supporting papers would be available. There's a lot more to this than just holding it in public. You then have important information which you really need to put your case forward and properly represent your members. Can I just move now to... Yeah.
Can I just speak... To avoid any suggestion of misrepresentation of the reality here, we were able to attend. We were not contributing members at these meetings. I just want to make sure that is properly understood.
This is the previous meetings when they were held in public.
Even in the previous meetings, we were not contributing members. We were there in an observation capacity.
But at least you could hear quite clearly and see transparently what was going on.
Just on that again for clarity, maybe helpful. Actually, the development whereby we now get papers, or surprisingly, we got papers prior to the last meeting a few days beforehand, I think that's very helpful as well. So that's a helpful development by the SPA.
Mm-hmm. The SPCA recently approved the 2017-18 budget and includes a £47.6 million revenue deficit. What discussions and input have you had prior to the budget being presented, and could I have your views on how this will impact?
We had no discussions prior to, although we had some understanding just what the budget deficit was. The audit commission had a look at that, and we knew that was there. I was surprised to see, I think it was described as an underlying budget deficit. I'd never heard of anything like that before, but actually there is that £47 million shortfall. The reality of that is it's going to have an impact, maybe not now, because I think there's arrangements in place for that to be covered, but in future it will have a massive impact on how we deliver services. I mean, 2026 is all about identifying where the demand is, about reducing that demand and identifying efficiencies. There are going to have to be significant changes into the way that we deliver business to actually balance our budget. And I can't see that being done without losing staff and staff across the board.
Yeah. Again, through yourself, convener, like Craig has highlighted, we had no discussions around it with the specifics, although we were aware of the generalities of the cut, of the scale of the cuts that were going, or the scale of the hole that was going to be presented in the budget. I think what's probably most concerning about even that is that the budget that was passed contains unidentified savings, even within that 47 million. And that in itself is going to be particularly interesting as to how they're going to be addressed.
Yeah, similar point of view to my colleagues there. We haven't really been part, we were aware of the generalities surrounding it, but clearly, as I've alluded to earlier on, item 5.4 within the 17-18 budget refers to the application of a non-recurring vacancy factor saving of 4 million to the police staff budget. Now, that alludes to a number of unfilled police staff vacancies across the organisation, and like I say, we're yet to kind of see exactly what that's broken down into.
So you really would have to analyse that quite clearly, yeah, so that we don't go back to a situation where police end up backfilling again and taking off the front-line duty.
Before you move on, can I just... Do you want to come in on a supplementary on that point? And then I'll bring you back in.
Steele's point about unidentified savings, are you able to kind of quantify the scale of those unidentified savings, so that we have a kind of picture of what the kind of total is?
Off the top of my head, the short answer is no, but from memory, it was identified in the budget document, and I will make sure that a copy is forwarded on for the attention of committee members.
That'd be helpful, thank you.
The next question is quite a big question, really. What do you consider to be the financial priorities of Police Scotland and the SPA going forward? And are you all on the same page? I suspect I know the answer already to the latter part of that question. Well, if Stuart... Stevenson wants to come in a little bit, and I'll ask an aspect of this and then leave you to answer Stuart on that one. My real concern is here, going back to the letter from Derek Perman, that on the basis of previous discussions and given that you've been implementing our new governance arrangements in 2017-18, I've decided that it would be timely for HMIS to schedule a statutory inspection into state efficiency and effectiveness of the SPA authority. Now, in terms of operating policemen, the SPA is potentially looking at the integration of the railway police. It's going to be germane to the railway policing agreements. It's going to have the ability to negotiate and to make sure these are a success with the railway operators. But here we have, which is tantamount to a vote of no confidence in the SPA, so much so that the HMIC, or at least if no confidence, the concerns being sufficiently severe to warrant a statutory inspection into state efficiency and effectiveness of the authority. Under these circumstances, is it sensible in any way, shape or form to consider giving the SPA even more responsibility?
Again, through yourself, Convener, I'm sure Derek Penman can speak for himself, but I certainly wouldn't take the view that the indication of an inspection of any part of the area under which he's got responsibility for performing his duties is in any way a signal that there's a lack of confidence or a vote of no confidence. It may well be the case, but you'd have to ask him if that's his intention. I thought we'd done the railway policing stuff, to be honest, but for what it's worth, I don't envisage that the Scottish Police Authority would be any less capable of dealing with whatever comes its way for railway policing than the current arrangements that exist for governance of railway policing. That's just a
Mr.
generic
Livingston.
View.
Certainly on the issue of railway policing, I believe that the committee that would actually deal and address with some of the governance of the integration of British Transport Police would be a private committee. So, again, if we're talking about legitimacy and transparency, then that doesn't necessarily bode well. As to whether British Transport Police should be integrated, certainly I think the question was framed that it was more a matter of how we integrate as opposed to whether we indeed we should. And I think there was quite significant input by the British Transport Police Authority, whose proposals just seem to be kind of dismissed out of hand.
Thank you.
Stuart, did you want to come in?
Well, I wanted to move to a more strategic view, which I think the submission from the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents makes the comment in relation to the 26th strategy, the Association is supportive of the general aims and objectives. Now, that's not, you know, a green light in total. And similarly, Unison Scotland make an interesting, and I think a other point in relation to that, there's a requirement for partner agencies to buy into the 2026 project. So what I think the committee would be interested in, what I'm certainly interested in, is, first of all, do we, in general terms, where things are, think that the 2026 strategy is moving in the right direction? But more fundamentally, is it good enough to start to inform some of the more tactical decisions that need to be made in the shorter term? Or is there more work required on that strategic vision that's encapsulated in the 2026 strategy? Because to try and suggest what we might spend in 25-26 is spurious at this distance. But does it help us understand where the police is going in the shorter term? Because I think that's the important thing for us today.
In terms of police in 2026, it was certainly reassuring from Unison's point of view that for the first time there was a quite frank admission that backfilling took place within Police Scotland. And certainly in terms of the campaign that we've run of moving towards a balanced workforce and best value, it was reassuring to see some of those terms creeping into that. At the same time, and some of the work that we see in terms of organisational change, we do see areas of collaboration like partnership working and so on. Some of those posts have actually been removed due to there no longer being a commitment from local authorities and so on to continue to finance these.
Just to intervene, it would be helpful if you could give us some specific examples rather than, because what you said is a quite open general statement, just to help us understand.
Yes, it is. There's certain collaborative roles which are financed by local authorities. So there were certain roles like a youth justice assessor that would actually organise and arrange meetings that would be between various stakeholders, people around vulnerability and risk. And if there was no longer a commitment from the local authority to finance that, then the onus then switches to the police in terms of whether they can continue to finance that. So there's a lot of work to be done in terms of establishing these boundaries and kind of harnessing the synergies between who we collaborate with and how we go about it. It's a long road, I believe, but certainly there's a lot of value there that we can release.
26 covers a number of different issues. I think fundamentally as a strategy, there's nothing in it that gives me much surprise as a progressive police service looking at. And I think police services prior to Police Service Scotland and other police services elsewhere are looking at similar things. So I put that into that context. I think there's a bit important bit about 2026 which talks about working within the budget. And that's a massive issue for policing, because policing don't set the budgets. It's politicians and others that set the budget. It's up to the police service then to make sure that they are delivering that in the best way we can. And I think there's really important bits I mentioned earlier about how we identify what a real demand is, how we reduce the demand and how we create efficiencies. And 2026 talks about efficiencies in the back office and talks about making sure that we prioritise the front line. We'd accept that. But fundamentally, for me, 2026 is about the start of a discussion with the communities that we serve to actually, what do you want from policing in the future? Because there's massive strains on policing. I mean, policing demand has gone up over previous years. You know, the thought that because crime's down, policing's gone down is a fallacy. There's massive demands on policing, and our communities need to understand where we are with that. It was interesting, I think today HMIC down in England and Wales spoke about the massive demand that mental health's placing on policing, and that's something we need to engage with communities, and they need to understand, and our partners need to understand how we're going to improve on that. Policing's far too important to be left to the police, and that's a phrase that's been said many times, but we really do need to start talking about how we'd actually deliver that in Scotland.
Before coming to Calum, Steele, when you talk about the tactical determining of budgets in the short year-by-year term, are you therefore saying that when we describe the budgets for next year, the year after, we should always be doing so in the context of what the strategic objectives are, rather than simply the tactical requirements of the year to year.
Absolutely. I mean, right. that's what strategies, but within policing terms, yep. we're quite familiar to using strategies, yep. and that informs tactical delivery. Absolutely.
That's what I heard you say. I just wanted to hear you say it,
absolutely.
If you see what I mean. Cal.
Yes, thank you. And again, through yourself, Camilla, I would align myself with what Craig has just said. I mean, the policing priorities are determined by government. And the strategic plan thereafter should be a matter for the authority. But I believe that there is something actually much more fundamental than the issue of, you know, partner agency buy-in and whether we've got this right for what the shape of policing could look like in the next number of years, and that is that the service itself has to buy in. And when we're starting, and indeed it's recognised in the foreword, that's jointly signed by the Chief Constable and the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority, where they say, the input and well-being, and it's off the staff, are critical to our continued success. Yet, at the recent meeting of the Scottish Police Authority, when they were talking about the morale issue and the sense of well-being that the staff were feeling, that the Chief Constable openly conceded that he did not see the situation improving any time soon. And that seems to me to be a fundamental weakness in any success that is recognised in their introduction about delivering a change programme, particularly one as significant as 2026. Now, I'm sure the Chief Constable would say that he is not giving up on morale, but certainly it could be conceded, certainly it could be construed that by saying, I don't see it getting better anytime soon, that is exactly what he was doing. And when you have a situation where, and again, I've distilled this down for police officers, 16%, only 16% of police officers responding to the previous survey said that they believe they had enough resources. 13% believe that managers were committing to improving ways of work. 12% believe the service was changing for better. 11% felt that they were positive about the future. Against that backdrop, when you have a tacit statement, and it'll be recorded in the notes of the Scottish Police Authority, the last meeting that took place on the same date as the terrorist incident in Westminster. It's difficult to align that with the introductory foreword in the strategy that says the input and well-being are critical to continued success. That, for me, is much more important than what it is believed the aspiration of the future of the police service is going to be, because if you cannot persuade, and it's not just the 17,234-ish police officers, it's also the large number of support staff, although depleted number of support staff, because the results for support staff are similar to those for police officers. If you can't bring your workforce with you, then this is a waste of time. And as things stand just now, because of what we've discussed from the very start of this, when we're only talking about generalities rather than specifics, it's difficult to see how you're going to make that quantum leap between saying we've got to introduce a culture change, and culture change is going to be successful to the implementation of this strategy, to then making it happen. Police officers, I'm not saying we're change weary, but we are weary of being told that things are going to get better and not seeing it. And often it is because of organisational failure, not because of a lack of willing on behalf of individuals themselves.
Did you still want to come in on this, or are you happy? Before I bring in Ben, can I ask you then, obviously the public expectation on what the police force should provide, and the demands on the police force from the public has changed dramatically over the years, and it seems to be almost on a yearly basis what the public expect from the police gets bigger and bigger and greater. Now, was there a tipping point for that change? Is it just because of the general societal change? Is it because you are expected to do tasks that other partner organisations may have done in the past? And do you think it's enough of that is taken into consideration in the 2026 document to ensure that the force itself is brought along with the changes that are happening?
I think, I mean, certainly one of the strong themes within 2026 is the idea of establishing capacity through demand reduction. Certainly, we believe that's sound, but there's certain examples where, particularly in the early stages of restructure, restructure's taken place and demand has actually increased, both internally and externally. I think you can view what's happened within C3 as an example of that, where call volumes have actually increased. And allied to that, you've got station closures, which then force demands down other channels and so on. You know, in terms of how we actually overcome that, we actually require, you know, significant ICT investment and investment in staff in order to make that happen. There are certain areas where we advocate the idea that police staff can actually are a more cost-effective solution at times to actually addressing some of these issues of demand.
Callum or Craig, do you want to comment?
Yes, convener. I'm not sure that public expectation has changed. I think the public has always had a fairly high expectation of what it wants its police service to do, and at the risk of stealing Malcolm Graham, Assistant Chief Constable Malcolm Graham's language on this, the public have always known what the police do because it's the public that ask us to do it. I think, you know, when you ground yourself in that reality, it kind of acts as a stark wake-up call that when we talk about, changing priorities and demands and expectations and all the rest of it, it's actually the public that tell us what it is they expect a police service to do. And whilst there are, I think it probably can be distilled down, and I'm going to steal someone else's language, the public love the police. They just don't want to pay for us. Or the public love the police, but politicians don't want to pay for us. So there's, you know, there are all those realities that exist in our wider society and the expectations that are placed upon us. But undoubtedly, there is a huge change away from criminalising people in the way that we have in the past. Now, that's undoubtedly a good thing. And the much trotted out line about only one in five incidents results in a crime being recorded, that's as a consequence of a change of policing approach, arguably not as a consequence of a change of reality. Because what once upon a time would have been a crime and resulted in someone getting locked up is now, whilst it is still probably still legally in terms of its definition, a crime, it doesn't result in a crime being recorded and results in some kind of diversionary activity being put in place. Now, these additional diversionary activities from a societal perspective are certainly much better and more effective than simply locking someone up and then passing them on to someone else only to get them back in a few hours, days, weeks and months' time. So that element of it has changed, and the wider holistic approach, and it's far from perfect, let's not kid ourselves, but the wider holistic approach to the care and well-being of our societies is much more labour-intensive than just simply turning up, dragging someone away and putting them in a cell.
Thank you. Craig.
When you talk about timing, I think one of the significant timings would be April 13 when the service was brought into being. I mean, just for the record, our association was absolutely supportive of the single service and still think it's the right thing and don't think we could deliver policing the way we are doing now without it. The service has produced great dividends and great performance with regard to operational policing, but in other sides we've not been so good at it. I think individual officers feel under pressure because under greater scrutiny, and I think the fact for single service has accentuated that, and I think some people have used this as a rubber ball to kick around, and that hasn't been helpful to individuals, and I don't think that's been helpful to the public in understanding just what it is we're delivering. But I think we as a service fundamentally need to get better explaining to the public what we actually do, and I think that's been one of our failings over previous years, and I don't think that's helped.
Okay, Liam.
Yeah, Craig, you may have just been touching on it. I mean, I'd probably take issue with something that Callum said earlier about the public know what we do because the public ask us to do it. I mean, certainly one of the concerns I hear raised at a local level, and I think it's reflected nationwide, is the amount of officer time that's taken up in involvement in managing cases for vulnerable adults and others, which is entirely appropriate. I'm not entirely sure, though, that the public recognises the extent to which that engagement is ongoing. It's not just an interaction then the individual's passed on to community mental health or whoever. There's actually that continued involvement beyond the initial contact, which I don't think the public does see and doesn't realise that it takes up an amount of police resource on an ongoing basis. So I think it may be a nifty phrase, but I'm not sure necessarily that that Mr. Graham has it entirely right in terms of the public's expectation.
Just going back to policing 2026, we've heard you say, explain at some length about how you felt officers and staff didn't have enough input into it. I'm just wondering if you could say anything positive about it. What are the positive aspects of it within the report that you see? Can you?
I think it's fundamentally a positive report. I think it's looking to the future policing and how we'll deliver policing in the future. I think there's been great attempts for staff to have an input into it. I understand why staff may feel that's not important for them. I think if you picked a police officer in the street just now and talked about 2026, I'm not convinced they'd know that much about it. But I think fundamentally it is the right direction to go in. And I think part of the challenge is, and Calum's already said that, is actually bring our staff along with us so they can understand what 2026 is about.
So that would be your specific complaint about it, the fact that the staff weren't included as much as they should have been?
I don't think it's a complaint. I think there's been attempts to get staff included. That is very difficult. Yeah. The report says very simple things like the new chief constable, as he then was in last year, talked about the four pillars, and he talked about organisational capability, organisational culture, and changing that. That is massive. That is going to take some time to do, and we've got to build on what's happened in the past. So it's a difficult job, but I think the service are trying. I'm not sure they're going to achieve it or how quickly they're going to achieve it.
That was my next question was, is it too late to have a culture change you talked about?
No, culture develops over time.
That'll be ongoing.
Yeah, it'll take some time, but we need to accept the culture is going to have to change at a time when the number of officers and staff available to deliver is going to reduce. And if we live within our budget, which is a lot of what 2026 is about, that's going to have to happen. There are some efficiencies and savings that can take place. These are going to be difficult.
Mm. I mean, are any of them achievable, do you think? I mean, you're saying difficult. Do you think ultimately they will be achievable or they will have to be achieved?
Absolutely achievable. I mean, efficiencies are always achievable. We also talks about the operational delivery model and the operating model, we need to look at that differently. I mean, we've come under pressure with regard to how quickly we answer the phone or how quickly we dispatch resources, and that's become a target rather than looking at what we're doing with the calls that are coming in and how we're responding to them. So that's one way we can look at things differently, mm-hmm. and we can maybe make some savings. A lot of the demand within policing, we talk about reducing demand, a lot of the demand is internal demand or failure demand, and we need to look at that differently. We need to stop the culture of everything having to be reported up. We need to give more discretion and freedom to our very able officers who are out in the front line and police staff and let them go on and do their job.
Okay, thank you. Calum, do you?
Yes, thank you, and again, through yourself, convener. I don't often try and pick up on what's been said by my friend from us, but I actually think that what Craig said a few moments ago about the culture will have to change indicates the very real difficulty that there is in implementing the changes in this, or certainly the changes that this document lays some of the foundations for. Because it's telling staff that your culture has to change, your approach has to change, or the organisation's culture has to change, does not necessarily mean it's going to happen. But what I think is, to answer the specific question about the positives, I think this document does a lot of things. The one thing that it doesn't do, and self-evidently no strategy document ever would, but it's obviously the thing that will matter most to the police service and to police officers and staff working in it, is the how. It's not the what the problem is or why there is a problem, but the how are we going to change it. And the how doesn't exist anywhere in this, and that's a big part of it. Now, I don't think that the document is either here nor there for what it's worth. But if I'm looking for positives, I will say this, and I hope that despite the fact that I disagreed with his comment a few seconds ago, that Craig will agree with me on this, that what I am enormously positive about is that we have, and I mean we as a Scottish Police Federation, have been actively engaging with the 2026 team. Chief Superintendent Angela McLaren and Malcolm Graham in particular, and I have to say there's also been significant buy-in from Deputy Chief Constable Ian Livingston around about this whole matter. And we are hoping to bring, to work with the service, an academic of significant international standing to try and help identify and put in, and work with us on some of the change challenges that are in place. place, or certainly that are likely to be presented. And the service willingness to work with us in that manner thus far has been second to none. I would say in a way that I have never seen it before. They're not quite biting our hand off, but if you know, metaphors apply, that would be as close as you would get. There is lots of engagement and willingness to utilise expertise, international expertise, to try and put in place something that will work for the future of the whole of the communities in Scotland. And self-evidently, you know, this consultation is still live. I know it sounds like we're giving it a bit of a hard time in terms of some of what's been said, but I sense from the team, and Craig and Drew will speak for themselves, a genuine willingness to try and make sure that they take on board some of the issues that are being presented to them. But that's not to say that in any way underestimates the scale of the challenge that the service is facing.
Okay, thank you.
Ben.
Thank you, Convener. afternoon, panel. I was going to ask about workforce profile and the 2026, talking about the maintenance of current police numbers in this coming year. But the changes in the profile of the workforce are expected by 2020. But I wanted to read you something out, all three of you, something out of 2026, and ask if you could answer in light of this phrase that's in the document. And it is, and I quote, "We will increase the flexibility of the terms and conditions for both existing members and new roles with the organisation." How do you see things going as regards the workforce profile, and have you concerns about your members' terms and conditions?
Certainly, Unison has significant concerns. Where, you know, as I've touched on earlier on, the harmonisation project is overdue. Certainly, we would expect that they will seek to not necessarily improve, but modernise terms and conditions. And certainly, that's something that we will have to engage with our members on. In terms of the workforce profile, Unison has been calling for a thorough breakdown of exactly what the workforce makeup is, where police officers are deployed, and certainly there are attempts to address our concerns by producing a workforce planning model that will actually show where people are deployed. Previously, issues such as gender segregation within policing hasn't been available. It was actually included at the last SPA board meeting as part of the equality outcomes for the Scottish Police Authority. Previously, all of this sort of analytical data in relation to what impact 17234 has on the working population within Police Scotland has been unavailable. I don't know why that's the case, but certainly that is the case, and we would seek to see that's addressed as part of the 2026 strategy, that we actually start to look at exactly what our workforce makeup is. I think prior, between 2007 and 2012, it's mentioned within Unison Scotland Stewart report that only 3 out of the 8 legacy forces had actually conducted any sort of research into what roles could be civilianised within policing. I think it was Central Scotland, Strathclyde and Tayside. There's a bit of a shortage as to exactly what we could do to deliver best value in a balanced workforce within the framework of 2026.
Come.
Yeah, thanks. And again, through yourself, Convener, I think to answer the question directly, I think that comes back to the how. You know, it's all very well saying the what and the what and the why, but it's ultimately going to come down to the how. One thing that I am acutely aware of is that the terms flexibility and modernisation mean cheaper. Yeah. They always have done. Anyone who says otherwise is lying. Self-evidently, if there's going to be a how that looks towards making it cheaper and more inconvenient to work as a police officer, then that will work against the very success, the very important thing that they have to do, and that's trying to change the culture do that against a background of reducing numbers and increasing demand. It's difficult to see that is anything other than a Pandora's box for problems.
we very much welcome the bit about flexibility, and I think that's a really important part as we move forward. And actually, flexibility can at times be cheaper, and actually by encouraging retention of a lot of our staff, you know, those with caring responsibilities, I know as our association's unrepresentative of the communities, particularly gender, but also elsewhere, our force executives even less representative, so I think there's a big challenge for them there. We have discussed that particular part with 2026 project team, and our advice to them was to look down at England and Wales, see what tinkering with terms and conditions has done, and it's been an absolute disaster down there, and it's done nothing for morale, and I see no benefit in bringing that to Scotland whatsoever.
Very specifically then for the Operational Police Officer Staff Associations, do you see any threat to the role of the status of Office of Constable inherent in any of that statement?
I think as is always the case, the question would have to be a case of wait and see, but there is always a danger that could be, you know, that could be one of the un, you know, or certainly the implied conditions that comes from the expression. In 2004, I was at the Scottish Police College at the launch, the very significant launch of what was then called Flexible Working Works. It was an ACPOS initiative, and the then president of ACPOS, and I think the chief constable of Grampian, and may have been one and the same, stood up in front of a packed lecture hall and said, I can see no reason at all why every police officer in Scotland cannot work flexibly if they wanted to. And yet here we are, 13 years later, and let me tell you, trying to work flexibly is the devil's own job in the police service of Scotland. And that, in its own right, the real lived experience of police officers is not going to be changed by writing some warm, cuddly words on a page.
And of course, we would all have an entirely different view of what flexibility is. I suspect.
I can accept that. But the question about the challenge of the constable, I hope it improves it. I see that there have been some moves where we'd look at trying to bring in non-warranted officers. I think that's a dangerous thing to do. But I don't think that's the same as having the right person with the right skills, being paid the right money to do the right job. And I see some benefits in that. And I do think there's a number of roles getting carried out by police officers just now that could be more ably carried out by police staff colleagues. And actually, over the last few years, Drew spoke about it earlier, we have taken officers off the front line and put them into these offices to do jobs not as well as those people that we've lost. I think, not disturbingly, but we had some concerns when we saw some early manifestations of 2026 being advertisement of some very highly paid jobs within the service. We have raised our concerns with that with the executive and with others, and we've been provided with some reassurance that these jobs are people who've got the specific skills to come in and make a change. And I think it's fair to say that 2026 is about transformation, and actually the service has been absolutely terrible at transformation over the last few years. So if we need to bring in some skills to actually drive that, I think that's the right thing to do. But we need to remember that we cannot denude the service of our members who've got real operational responsibility, and we need to be careful when we talk about reducing the number of supervisors we've got elsewhere in the service.
Can I read another quote to you, please? Then it's from the Chief Constable, who said, again I quote, a narrow assessment of success predicated simply on crime figures, officer numbers and cost savings no longer represents the true test of an effective police service capable of meeting the challenges of the future. Do you have any concerns about that statement at all?
I think the truth, again, through yourself, Convener, that statement was always true. I think the difficulty that this Chief Constable and many others have is that they created the illusion that the very thing they're saying is no longer the measure of success. It's the very thing that they always said was the measure of success. And I'm not quite saying it's a Damascene conversion, but it does certainly have the appearance of one.
Okay, if I may, a further question?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. Drew, you mentioned the year 2007, and I don't have the figures to hand, but I would wager that there's at least been 2,000, possibly even 3,000 additional police officers since that period.
I think over a period since 2007, we've lost approximately 2,000 members of police staff over that period of time. As I've alluded to earlier on, there's a large number of police staff vacancies. I think if you look at certain business areas such as C3, there was an uplift to approximately 45% police officers within area control rooms. Now, I think part of HMIC's findings in their final report was that they would have expected a more detailed rationale and supporting data to justify this workforce balance, when clearly in the legacy force areas we had area control rooms and indeed service centres which were more intensively staffed with police staff. So some of the justifications behind that just aren't clear as to why we need to protect police officer numbers in these business areas.
If I may convene, I mean, 2007 is a very fortuitous year because, of course, that was the year when every politician and his or her granny was standing on a manifesto commitment to increase police officer numbers, with the notable exception of your own party, it has to be said. So I know that in 2007, simply because it's where the 1,000 number was anchored to, that there were 16,234 police officers, so the uplift was, you know, broadly 1,000.
Thank you. Can I ask then the effect of that 1,000? Because I mean, we need to understand, is the finance in place to deal with the workload? Has the workload been assessed? Are we deploying the appropriate people? And I would suggest that Drew's told us that we're not, to do the appropriate tasks. Is that part of 2026? That fairly simple series of things, which would be a very complex process and or could be treated as such. But that's what you do. What are we to do and what do we need to do it? In terms of human resource and financial resource?
I think that is part of 2026, and I can't see any way we can look forward without looking very carefully at just how we do put resource out. We've always said that 72.34 was just a number that was made up sometime, and whether that's too many, too less or not isn't really for us to decide. What we need to make sure is that we make that the officers and the budget available to us is used most effectively and efficiently as it can be.
Thank you very much.
I mean, Yes, I did. I mean, the issue of demand here is very important because, demand comes in many ways, shapes and forms. And it's not just the number of times that people phone the police. There are demands, and then, of course, there are expectations that come from reassurance and community presence and patrolling and proactive initiatives. You know, we have to have enough police officers to be able to deal with elections. Let's be honest about it, we have no shortage of them. We have a Scotland-England football fixture coming up. We have sporadic no-notice demonstrations take place. These things in their own right are demands that do not feature in the broad statistics that we have. Finance and indeed the way in which the organisation has responded to some of the financial challenges creates additional demands. We have reduced our custody centres. We are now transporting people on greater distances in the backs of cars to get them to put them in a cell. That is a danger, mm-hmm. And it is something that I believe is probably one of the biggest risks the service is facing. So there are a whole host of different things, but fundamentally, I do not disagree with the question that was asked by Mr. Finney, in that you have to understand the holistic nature of what it is the police is and are expected to do before you can then come to an answer, because traditionally, the answer was always what your starting point was. If you had 1,000, and the question was how many police officers you had, if the budget wasn't going to change, the answer was always going to be 1,000. I genuinely fear that in this particular exercise, we are looking at the money first, rather than coming up with the true answer of what it is that policing in Scotland could cost, and then have a conversation with people like yourselves and communities about whether they would be willing to pay for it.
Okay. Ben.
Convener, just very briefly on that point, Calum Steele, I wondered, is there a responsibility for all of us as politicians and yes, those working as public servants to and beyond to raise greater awareness of the fact that demand in policing is at the level it is and of the complexity of it, to try and create a greater awareness among the public and other service providers around the complexity and of the demand issue as things stand?
Yes, I believe it is. This is probably the only answer that I could give to that. Previously, one of the committees in this building had a round table around about the demands that are placed upon the police service. And when we left, certainly when I left with the evidence session on that particular day, some of the people that were present said to me, you know, let's not kid ourselves, the police service is the out of hour service for every other service. And I think that's, you know, if we maintain that expectation, which I don't think is ever going to change, then we have to make sure that that catch-all safety net for everybody else is not in itself undermined as a consequence of the very real budget challenges that we face. Because ultimately, whilst police officers may not be happy at their work, whilst members of support staff may not be happy at their work, whilst we might be working long hours and getting assaulted and injured, it is our communities that will feel the greatest brunt of that, and that will result in an ebbing of public confidence across the piece. It will drive down economic activity, and you know, as a nation, we will go backwards, because you know, the fundamental building blocks to successful communities start with shelter and sustenance, and then safety and security. If you take as a given that at the very least we have basic shelter and sustenance, then you cannot then undermine the importance of safety and security thereafter.
Don't come back in, no?
No.
No. Given the discussions that we've had in the last hour and the issues that we've talked about, does the panel think that the ambition and the aspiration in the 2026 policing document are achievable in the timescale that's set out? Reason?
The document talks a lot about what the problem is, and it talks about what the service needs to do. It doesn't say, although it's implied in a lot of places, what the service is going to stop doing. If I give a very simple example, there is an underlying assumption that if you're a frail woman in your dotage, that you are more that you are going to be more affected as a victim of crime than a young strapping male. You know, there is no scientific evidence that that's the case. You know, there is a danger that that the service moves into, in certain areas of crime, facilitators for the insurance industry. I don't think that's going to be good for you know, issues of public confidence. There was a fairly withering commentary piece in one of the tabloids, I forget which one, might have been The Record or The Sun, fairly recently, about Bill Leckie's own experiences of being a victim of crime. And I think that whilst there was a lot of hyperbole in that commentary piece, I think it lays bare some of the real concerns that exist out there, that the police service risks being seen as walking away from certain elements of the communities, whilst we talk about chasing other parts of it. I don't think it should be one or the other. It's got to be one and the other. If we give up, or are seen to be giving up, on community presences and community engagement and existence, and taking seriously the concerns that exist, then we will lose the public support. The importance of tackling cybercrime, which is alluded to fairly heavily, and this is also something that I think risks being overplayed simply because of the reality of geopolitics. If we're looking at people calling each other names and being offensive on Facebook and Twitter, and let's be honest about it, there's no shortage of them, then you know, we can tie up the police service forever and a day and we'd be doing nothing else. But if we're looking at the complexities of online fraud, child exploitation, paedophilia, so on and so forth, many of these crimes take place through multitudes of proxy servers located in nations across the world that we just simply will not be able to get access to. And identifying the problem is one thing, but pretending we're going to be able to solve them is entirely another. And that whole cyber element of it needs a much more honest discussion than just talking about it in the hope that people will believe that because it's an online crime, that therefore the service must throw a fortune at it, even though it may not result in any material change in the experience of the member of the public who may be a victim of crime through that medium.
Okay, Craig. Or
I think Calum could have probably stopped at no there, but I think 2026 itself is interesting. It's a 10-year strategy. We've only got 9 years left to deliver it. It was an unfortunate term. I don't think we should have called it 2026 to start with. I filed it next to 2025 and 2020, which were other initiatives we should actually started. My view is that it will succeed insofar as we try and look at what we're doing in a different way, and I think that's a big challenge. But there again, if we'd listened to people like Professor Harry Burns a number of years ago and started putting all the resources in early intervention, we might not be in the position we're in just now.
Okay.
Yeah, I would kind of agree. It depends exactly how prepared and the planning and preparation that goes into actually delivering, you know, competent and coherent ICT strategies and workforce planning models. It certainly talks a good game in terms of identifying where the risks lie. I think hearing Craig speak about Sir Harry Burns, I don't know if anyone else here has heard him speak, but his ideas around salutogenesis and identifying the problems, if we're actually foisting people down more remote platforms in terms of contacting the police and leaving them more isolated, to what extent then do we then deliver a self-fulfilling prophecy? I think there's all these sorts of ideas which are very good within the strategy document, but it's actually addressing them, the how, as Calum pointed out.
Do you want to come in?
Yeah, just on that how point, I mean, obviously we've heard concerns from the Auditor General about incomplete records and poor financial management. I think at an earlier session, Calum, I asked you about the expectation that the deficit of 180 million and growing within Police Scotland was going to be turned around in a matter of the next 2-3 years, which, frankly, given what's happened to date, seems to lack credibility. And whatever the how is going to come with a price tag attached to it. So, I mean, are you any more confident that the financial underpinning for 2026 is credible, or that are we just being told that these deficits that have built up are going to be turned around because SPA and Police Scotland feel that that's what we need to hear?
I think 2026 is more about changing the way we're doing things, about creating capacity, and that's the real challenge. It sounds really simple. I'm not convinced we're going to be able to do that within the time frame. I think we can try, but other demands will come in. I think I6 was put forward as it was going to increase capacity. Well, we didn't achieve that, so we've got real challenges in doing that. But whether we achieve it or not, we probably can, because we can project ahead and reduce the number of police officers that we recruit. 2026 talks about reducing police staff as well as bringing other police staff in. We can do that, and that will balance the budget. Is that the police service that you want?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, again, through yourself, Convener, I agree with, you know, the broad observations of Craig Suttie there. You know, the service can balance the budget if it wanted to, but it would, you know, the question would be at what particular cost. I know members will be aware that there's a narrative that the failure to deliver I6 has set the service back 5 years. I personally think it's much more than that. You know, we have very fragile and antiquated IT. All of these things impact on the capacity of the service. If we don't deliver on our IT, we impinge on the ability to create additional capacity to deal with the demand, and that is undoubtedly the biggest problem. When the service was established against the expectation to save $1.1 billion in its first decade of existence, that was underpinned by the reality, or certainly the expectation, that I6 was going to be delivered. That's gone. Everybody knows it's gone. And as parliamentarians, every one of you, I believe, has an obligation to say, well, you can't really there after hold the service to deliver savings based upon something that no longer exists. I think it's also worth noting that when the budget was, or certainly when the expectations were set, there was a very real and totally different terror threat across the world. And that in its own right has created additional demands and drawdowns upon the police service. The service could, you know, can save its money. It's what it will mean for quality of investigation and quality of victim care. We know just now, in another part of, that's directly linked to the service, although it's not a service responsibility to deliver it, in the treatment of rape victims, particularly in Orkney and Shetlands, the experiences they have to go through because of the unavailability of medical professionals to undertake examinations. All of these things impact on the view in which the police service is held, because I suspect that as horrific an experience as it is to be a victim or survivor of rape, that the additional horrendous experience of having to wait several days before you can properly wash can only make that worse. And that will reflect badly on the police service, even though it is a medical consideration. So, we have those kind of issues. And ultimately, it's the wider justice arena that I believe makes it unattractive for, a suspicion rather than an evidence position. But I suspect it's a wider justice reality about the inconvenience and how court systems operate that makes it very, very unattractive for many people to put themselves forward to be in a position of giving evidence on a fairly regular basis. And I think that's even more challenging for female professionals because of the self-evident expectation they have of being the primary carers in their own societies. So there's a whole host of different things. You know, we can investigate our murders less. We can investigate our organised gangs and our organised criminals less. You know, we can undertake lesser investigations in a whole variety of different areas. But that will filter through into the experiences of victims, and it will filter through into the confidence of the public.
Very, very briefly, because I need to move on.
Just on the specific point about the financial management, financial oversight, I mean, the Auditor General was pretty explicit in her criticisms. Do you see evidence that those safeguards and that oversight has now been tightened up, and that looking ahead, we will not see some of the problems that have emerged in the past?
Speaking to senior members of the executive, I see that they do have that tighter. I think they've learnt from what's happened over the last few years. So I think we're in a better place. That doesn't take away from the very significant challenges they'll then have in delivering the budget.
I am more optimistic, but I am not completely convinced. I still see that we are a service that tends to be penny wise and pound foolish. Those elements of, penny pinching are what, again, go back to the undermining of the morale and confidence and the belief of the officers that are delivering the service. Up until very recently, I genuinely didn't believe that many of the senior managers in the service, and I include, a large number of Craig's members in that, and to some extent possibly even some chief officers, genuinely believed that there was a financial problem facing the service. It was a case of, we will continue to do this because we can, and because it's not going to be my problem, but I'm going to be retiring and someone else is going to have to pick up the pieces. And I actually think that the failure to communicate the reality of the financial situation amongst the wider workforce, rather than just in brutal terms of you're not going to be getting overtime and then something happens and or an initiative comes along and overtime was thrown at the most ridiculous of causes, then I think that the service was largely in many areas kidding itself as to the reality of what it was facing. We didn't deal well, and I actually don't believe it was a service issue as such, but it should have been better done by the authority. But we didn't deal well with the communication about the reduction in counter hours. We didn't deal well with the issue of station closures. All of these things, had they been much better explained, not just to the communities, but also to the police officers that had responsibilities for the areas, may have been less painful. But when you are up against a police service which is inherently cynical of many of the promises to save money and improve, and you're telling them that, we're going to close this station, but we're still going to have the same presence as we had before. Everybody knows that that's not the case, and they see it as nothing more than, cutting for the sake of it without necessarily understanding its impact on the wider organisational capability and capacity.
Very briefly, I'm sorry. Ask you to try and meet your...
Yeah, no, certainly. Certainly we're more optimistic. We kind of echo the sentiments of ASPS. I think the approaches to financial monitoring and reporting, including areas such as the Police Scotland internal audit strategy, are certainly positive developments. I think I would temper that with the fact that we'd like to see more of a shift from the management of cost to management of value. Case in point is in 4 years, C3 division was on £12.5 million over budget, and any suggestion of significant savings being delivered by that business area have kind of been somewhat eradicated, to the point that within the Scottish Government Gateway Review, it suggests that there are modest savings to be made within that programme now. So we've actually shut down multiple sites, but we're actually only delivering modest savings. So I think we'll have to actually be a bit more realistic about maintaining a footprint and what we can actually deliver in terms of localism across Scotland. I think we'll have to move away. Technology is developing at such a pace that we can actually look at how we maintain that footprint and profile within our communities.
I suppose this is a catch-all, right? It's been said, the Cabinet Secretary has said that at present, despite the transformation, then the right balance between civilians and officers in order to get the correct mix of staff has not yet been achieved. Now, you've already today given us lots of examples of that, but really what I want to drill down to is what kind of analysis, in-depth analysis, is there of this is the civilian staff, this is what they do, this is the core function, this is what we need to operate regardless. Now, you come to committee, you tell us that, but where is this written down? So it's right up there in every single decision that's taken. And the same with the number of police. Callum's already mentioned various things, this fear about going to cyber crime, is that really a priority when there's so many other things that are not recorded as crime, but you're involved in today? Day-to-day. So where do you actually get this down in paper, there to see whenever this discussion comes up, so you don't have to keep coming to whichever committee it is to keep telling us these things, that that's a given right there to be looked at from the very beginning when we're looking at where we have to make the difficult decisions about what to fund.
Could I make a plea that the witnesses answer very, very briefly, because we are running short of time.
Again, thanks, Convener. I think the very, very simple answer to that question is very little. Ironically, the area of the service that you'd expect to undertake has its corporate function. That is going to be reduced significantly, which is going to make it less likely that they're going to have the capability to do that in the future. But of course, with any element of analysis, you create a degree of bureaucracy, and there has to be an acceptance that in any large organisation, bureaucracy is going to be a part of the machine, and we've been stripping out much of what we have considered unnecessary bureaucracy over the past number of years.
I think that's what 2026 is about. Unfortunately, over the last few years, we've been looking at reducing our police staff members because we've done that to cut budgets, and I think we've done that in quite a brutal and caring and not very sophisticated way. So you're right, we do need to start building up from the bottom again, seeing what is we actually need to deliver and what skills we need to deliver that. So I think that's part of what 2026 is about.
Certainly, there were certain situations of business cases that were presented where police staff would be removed, and you know there would be a justification that, say, 20% or 30% of those duties would then be absorbed by local policing, and it simply isn't true. There are some units which deal wholly with citations work, firearms inquiries, and so forth. So that's a problem. We've basically stripped away the police staff resources and taken capacity away from police officers.
Yeah. As there are no further questions from committee, can I thank our witnesses for coming along today and for the evidence they have given us. We now move into private session. I'm going to suspend briefly to allow the witnesses and the gallery to clear. Thank you.